It's 1960, and look how happy Sharon and Karen and Joey are. And Bob has completely forgotten the horrors of the Second World War. They are happy because of this glass door. But to understand doors like the ones sold here, you have to go to the patent application. You know what? We'll get back to that. Cue the penguins. Because when Admiral Richard Byrd went to Antarctica in 1939, Science News reported that he adorned his lab with non-frosting window panes. And newspapers around the country shared the picture. But this technology had a far greater impact than helping Arctic researchers study cute penguins. A new type of window enabled everything from paradisal patios to a change in skyscrapers from ones that look like this to ones that look like this. And in this case, the breakthrough had a name. Thermopane changed Bob's world.
I was just curious, what attracted you to write about this and research this topic?
When I've told people, oh yeah, I'm doing a research project on insulated glass, you know, the response is always like, oh, what? The reality is that it changed the way that we did building enclosures radically and in a very, very short period of time. The way that building interiors were illuminated for hundreds, thousands of years was natural daylight, or you had to burn something basically to be able to see inside at night. When electricity came along in the 1870s, 1880s, that changes the formula, but not all the way, right? Electricity is still expensive for decades, and so you still have these very, very large windows to bring daylight, especially into offices.
One thing I was reminded of, I did this one little series on old movie studios, like in the silent era, and before they really got the lighting down, it's exactly what you're talking about, because they all look like greenhouses because they just have to adapt to this situation of not being able to have powerful enough light. That affects the architect's aesthetic at the time, is what you're saying.
But there's a real environmental penalty there, because the glass is a pretty good insulator, but the problem is that it has to be so thin to see through that you lose all of the heat in the building during the winter, or you pick it all up in the summer. So glass is both necessary, but also a problem.
As electricity got cheaper and more places started using heating and air conditioning, large windows kind of went out of style. In 1931, the Chicago Tribune wrote about architects laughing at the idea of glass walls. They were not feasible because glass was a great conductor of heat and cold, but people still wanted to see outside. Glass blocks like these were one solution. They insulated well. As a plus, they offered privacy, but you couldn't see out of them clearly, like real windows. So there has to be a wall between Bob and his children. Instead of watching them play, he's forced to ponder the unspeakable things he did during the war. But in 1934, Libby Owens Ford Glass Company announced a new glass process they acquired from a refrigeration engineer in Milwaukee.
This engineer realizes that if you can double the glass, right, and between those two layers of glass, take out all of the humid air and replace it with dried air, air with all the water taken out, you can get not only the insulating value of the two pieces of glass, but that thin layer of air in between does a really, really good job of preventing heat from jumping from one pane of glass to the next.
Builders are chasing something called R-value. It's a measure of insulation. Higher equals more insulation. That pink insulation in your wall, it might have a really high R value. A pane of glass is down at 1. Thermopane doubled that at more than 2, and it was still transparent. Newspapers reported that they extended the line, and soon, that double pane glass was down in Antarctica. And Thermopane salesmen were claiming Admiral Byrd said it kept his lab 75 degrees Fahrenheit behind the windows. Though the seal required some reworking over the next decade, Thermopane changed the possibilities for architects.
Thermopane gets going, but then competitors do start up pretty quickly, so it becomes a competitive marketplace for this type of dual system.
Pittsburgh Plate Glass, which is one of their big competitors, comes up with a slightly different way of doing it, and so they patent that, and they market it as Twindo, because it has two layers of glass. I would say by the 1960s, if you're putting a big window into any residential or office building, other than, you know, very, very temperate climate, you're probably just doing insulated glass almost by default.
Today, you can find triple pane windows and thin glass coatings like low E glass that have advanced the same idea. They can bump up that R value to above 3. At the same time, builders worry about all the glass walls we'll need to replace, often from seals that are breaking down. But the thermopane revolution really did change how people work and live.
The residential advertising for this is always a sliding glass door looking out onto very verdant landscape, which is basically saying, you know, here's a way of connecting your inside world and your outside world.
I noticed this blanket of air phrase a couple of times.
Even though it's very, very broad, wide open glass window, you're sort of cuddled up in a blanket.
The family at home is enjoying the convenience and the functional beauty of walls of glass, merging room with room, blending inside with outside.
Taking away the barrier between the inside and the outside is kind of socially and culturally what a lot of these mid-century modern homes were all about, like being able to see all of your stuff.
Thermopane was a way to stop staring at the past and start seeing the future.
I guess this is by Pittsburgh Plate Glass Company too. Is that kind of a different category?
Spandrel usually refers to the solid panel between the transparent ones. And it does two things. It covers up the edge of the floor plate, which is usually, you know, thick and kind of sloppy concrete. But for a long time, and this is a whole other rabbit hole, but for a long time, these glass curtain walls are running afoul of kind of old-fashioned fire codes that say you need to have a 3-foot, usually 3-foot brick wall between one window and the next. And so the way they got around that, like behind the dark green panels in this building, there's probably a brick wall, but they're putting a piece of opaque glass in front of it to give you the illusion of an all glass facade, right? Which was surprisingly like a fairly common thing.